Welcome to Inside the Taubman Approach podcast. I'm your host, Benjamin Harding. This new podcast is an inside look at the power of the Taubman Approach, an approach to working with playing-related problems such as discomfort, tension, pain, and injuries. Through firsthand experiences and discussions with some of the premier teachers of this approach, we'll be sharing how pianists at various stages of learning the piano have benefited and grown through applying the Taubman approach. Sponsored by the Galansky Institute. The Galansky Institute is on a mission to provide cutting-edge instruction to pianists based on the groundbreaking work of Dorothy Taubman. If you're interested in learning more about the Taubman approach, be sure to check out the show notes of this episode and follow links to sign up for our newsletter, to stay up to date with all that the Institute offers, including their premier subscription service that allows you to take lessons on the Taubman approach from anywhere. Let's get into today's episode. Today, we welcome Eden Agranat Meged to Inside the Taubman Approach. Welcome, Eden, to Inside the Taubman Approach.
Glad to be here.
Wonderful. And you're calling from London today, I understand. What is happening in London for you?
So I'm studying here since 2019.
Oh, wow. And what school are you at currently in London?
I'm at the Royal Academy of Music. So this is the first year of my master's degree.
Oh, that's fantastic. And you grew up in Israel?
Yes, I did.
And what part of Israel did you grow up in?
In Jerusalem.
Oh, my goodness. So the founder of the Galansky Institute, Edna Galansky, was also born in Jerusalem, which is a neat coincidence here as we begin this interview. And you came across the Taubman approach through studying with Bob Durso, who is a leading expert in our Galansky Institute. How did you come across Bob?
So I remember it was a few years before I actually sent an email to ask for his help. I heard an interview with him that is not up now, but it was very interesting. I could notice he's very humble, but yet he had things to say. He was challenged with questions and he had answers. So I thought, that's interesting.
Yeah. And so you found him online in a video kind of format. What prompted you to send an email to Bob Durso?
So at the time I was injured and I realized that without changing the way I play, nothing is gonna change. At that time, I got the tapes, and after four tapes, I understood, there's really something here. And after four and a half, I understood, I cannot do it myself. So then I decided to ask for help.
Indeed. And can you describe to our audience the extent of your injury? It was not a small injury. In other words, this was a significant injury that you were trying to solve.
Yes. So I think without any intervention, this would have been the thing that could stop me from pursuing music through the piano. I had a combination of tennis elbow and tendonitis, and the pain was quite unpleasant, but I could live with the pain. but my playing started to get worse with the pain.
Yeah, and a lot of inhibiting factors, I'm sure, began to arise as you experienced those kinds of serious injuries, tendonitis and tennis elbow. And so you got the Taubman tapes, began to go through those Taubman tapes. You got to 4.5 and you said, oh my goodness, I need help to pursue this, this approach. And so you reached out to Bob Durso at that point.
Yes.
Now, when you reached out to Bob, you were actually probably, I'm guessing, preparing for a major competition.
Not at that time.
Not at that time. Okay.
I was starting to think about this direction, but yes.
Okay, so you were beginning to think through the possibility of competing, but the injury was so significant that you needed help to begin to heal from this injury and then to expand the possibilities of your playing as a young pianist. So what happened kind of in that first encounter with Bob and those first lessons with Bob? And this is online, right? This is during kind of the pandemic.
So actually this was just before, so February 2020. So just a few weeks before everything happened. So I was lucky in that regard.
Wow. And so what were those first lessons like?
So we began kind of from the beginning, starting to learn the piano again. So the weeks before, I'm playing Schumann's Symphonic Etudes and Chopin Concerto. And then I start with how high should I sit? How should I just play a single note? And then acquiring more and more skills so I can get back to music.
At what point did you begin to experience relief symptom-wise from tendonitis and tennis elbow? At what point did you begin to experience some kind of relief from the pain?
So the injury was not so bad that I couldn't function in daily life. But the playing, it would start after 1 minute and persist after I stopped playing. Because I used an alternative strategy of playing after even 2.5 weeks with Bob, I could return to playing without feeling significant pain. So it was very interesting because I could feel that the muscles are still inflamed. So it took them time, a few months to fully heal, but I could play at that time without the pain because I was not using the same motions.
Indeed. So it gave your arm and elbow a chance to begin to heal and to utilize the Taubman approach along that journey of healing. But since you studied with Bob, you've had a remarkable piano career. A competition winner, not just a competition participant, but a competition winner in the J.S. Bach competition. How much further along were you with Bob when you entered into that competition?
So the competition itself was July 2022. So about 2 years.
2 years. And, you know, when people think about playing the music of Bach, we think about independent voicing. So what was that like to sort of relearn how to play Bach with the Taubman approach? And did the music get better for you?
I believe so. So it gave me new tools, but also challenges. So one thing Bob says is that if you change the motions, it would be better, but not magical yet. You have to retrain your kinesthetic sense. So sometimes you want to achieve something you achieved before, but now in a completely different way. I feel now I can have a more variety of touch, which is important. As you say, Bach music is consisted of many voices. Each has a voice of its own. So it's important.
Oh, that's fantastic. And so where you're at now in your piano journey, entering into a master's program in London, what would you say to folks that are curious about the Taubman approach, but yet a little bit hesitant? Maybe they've heard about different aspects of the Taubman approach that they really just can't believe. They have to sort of suspend their belief system just a little bit to even sort of engage in the Taubman approach. What would you say to folks like that, that are curious about it, that are interested? How would you encourage them to pursue the Taubman approach?
I think when you hear the information, it's very logical and kind of brings in a way some optimism to how we can improve. I think the crucial thing I understood when I watched the second part of the fourth day is that I can't do it by myself. So in some way, you have to run the experiment. You need someone to guide you through the process. And the way it is taught, the teacher is guiding you step by step. You don't have to invent the wheel. But unlike some other subjects, there's kind of no substitute to help. I think that some of the best teachers, they can give you a taste of it. I think Taubman was a master of it, kind of to give you a gateway drug experience to the approach. And that can convince you, no one's told me this before, and it makes a big difference.
Yes, and there are so many resources at galanskyinstitute.org where you can see many of our master teachers at work through our streaming service and sort of get a taste on our YouTube channel of what is possible at the various stages of learning the piano through the Taubman approach. It's quite remarkable. And then, I mean, you're at the highest level of piano playing in the world, and yet you were able to find just an incredible, eye-opening, creative pathway through the Taubman approach. In what ways are you still learning now in studying with Bob Durso? What kinds of things are you exploring right now?
In learning a piece and also in learning a craft, sometimes the last few steps are in a way the most difficult, because you are confronting the more complex problems and they're unforgiving. It's not good enough for it to be 80%. There is a very palpable difference when something is almost there and really there. And at the beginning also we worked just to keep me healthy. And now we have the time to work on the music and to see how this problem-solving mindset transfers to playing music and to art.
Indeed. And it is a holistic approach in learning how to make music at the highest level, regardless of where you're at professionally, regardless of where you're at musically, to make music at the highest level. That's the goal. That's the genius of this work, that it opens up those possibilities for everybody who's studying this approach. When you share with other pianists in your circle about your journey, what's kind of their reaction? What's kind of their reception of your story? What kind of conversations do you end up having as you share your journey with other pianists?
It's really telling when you share this work with other people. The work doesn't invalidate the other things that we know and the important things we learn elsewhere. But sometimes there are contradictions, and it's sometimes uncomfortable and sometimes actually inspiring. People don't know what to make of it at the beginning. And some are really drawn in, and some are kind of suspicious.
Yes. And we have all had those kinds of conversations to say, really, is this something that, you know, we can sort of invest our lives into as musicians, our musical lives into, so that we can grow as musicians and grow as human beings? Is this something that's gonna last, or is it something that we're gonna run up against the wall and that's it? You know, the show's over, the curtain is pulled up, and there's the wizard, so to speak, behind the curtain, Wizard of Oz style. But so far, so good. And in all the stories and the interviews that we've conducted here on the Inside the Taubman Approach have pointed to the remarkable benefit of studying this work. So you personally, Eden, you're not seeing any kind of barriers or limitations to your own artistic expression, are you?
Every time I discover something new, I say, I'm still learning, I'm a student, I have to be patient, and I see there's a long way in front of me.
Which is wonderful. And you've already accomplished so much. So where can folks find out more about your career and more about your journey?
Maybe my next step is getting better at those things. I have a very small YouTube channel, but in need of expanding.
Well, wonderful. And we will include all of the wonderful links for Eden on the show notes of this wonderful episode. And we're going to have you back, Eden, in in the near future, just to continue to follow your progress and journey in the Taubman approach as it applies to you studying, going out and winning competitions and recitals and concerti all over the world. So congratulations to you, and thank you so much for joining us here today.
Thank you.